Last time we're going to see each other for the main lecture.
Of course, it's Friday.
Yes, time flies in all inertial systems. Yes, hilarious relativity jokes. Speaking of relativity, I went down just a second ago to get myself some coffee for the next couple of hours. And I walked past the common room and some culprit had written down the Euler Lagrange equation on the whiteboard there. And I was thinking, was that because of this course? And somebody thought, you know what? Let's give the people in the common room all of the wisdom of Euler Lagrange. I'm just curious who it was. Well, really?
Someone had written E equals MC squared, and I was like, ah, no, that's not my form.
Very good, very good.
That's
very
not
good.
My form.
Very good. E is MC squared. It's a little more subtle than that, yeah? Okay, so before we get started with the last bit of material for this course, yes, I have graded midterms. Done this over the weekend. I'm pleasantly surprised with the grades. Now, don't put up your hand and ask, so what did I get? Because trust me, I don't know this by heart of 29 people. Some I sort of know in what region they are. Don't ask me that either. I propose that by the end of today's tutorial, I will give you the grades. You can also look at your exams also, of course, but with 29 people, going individually through every exam is not going to be possible in, you know, the 10 minutes or so that we're going to do this. So, but I would like you to go through the exercises with me at some point. So we have to find some way to make this work. We have two tutorials to go, but if you recall, I would like to use some of the tutorials to practice a little bit more with the Minkowski space-time diagrams. The amount of new stuff that I'm going to tell you today is actually not that much, so we have some time left. But I'm playing with the idea, but it depends on your agendas and your willingness. Maybe we can have some open session outside of the lectures for people who are interested, just to go through all the exercises, actually go through them one by one, not your particular individual how you did the exercises, but just this is how you could have done that. As an open invitation, feel free not to be there, but the difficulty might be that with 29 people, finding a moment in time where this works for everybody might be a little bit difficult, but I think it would be a good idea. Hi, come in. So, keep that in the back of your mind. Maybe at the end of the tutorial today, we can think about when in our schedules that would fit. But I would be very happy to do so. I think that would be a good idea. So, now, let's get started proper. Are there any questions at this point? Nothing. Everybody's crystal clear about everything so far. No. Okay. So today we're going to have the second part in our foray into Lagrangian physics. And as you know, the last time that we spoke, we introduced Lagrangian mechanics and we used it to derive rules for momentum and energy in a relativistic setting. And we also connected these things to each other. And so we ended up with this beautiful equation that tells you how momentum, relativistic momentum and relativistic energy and mass are all connected to each other. And what I would like to do today is actually do the same thing, but now in case things are moving in accelerated fashion. Of course, you yourself are still in an inertial frame, so you yourself are not accelerating with respect to other inertial frames and such, but we are looking at accelerated things themselves. Mm-hmm. Now, that will finally get us to that point where we've encountered many times before and was strongly suggested by the mathematics that we see before, that you yourself or masses cannot go faster than light. Mm-hmm. But we haven't fully proven it yet. And what I would like to do today is actually show you how that works. Okay? So by the end of today, the main lecture, you should know how forces work in special relativity. And that's the whole idea. And we're going to do this via the same route, Lagrangian physics. Hmm. Now, before I start writing on the board, you might recall that last week I had a flu. Crappy enough, I still have it. It's not quite that bad that I cannot just walk around and talk about physics. I can do it all the time, regardless of how I feel. But it does come with a crappy extra thing, and that is that my one ear is still blocked, so I can only hear from this side, which is extremely interesting because I cannot tell depth anymore. Okay, I have no idea where sounds come from, including my own. I just hear my own voice here somewhere, as if somebody's playing my voice. So if I'm going to ask you to restate your question every now and then, it's not because you did something wrong or because your diction is not good enough. It's simply because one of my ears is blocked, and it also gives me some opportunity to think about your question before answering. So I might actually pretend as if I'm not hearing you, okay, if the question is difficult enough. Okay, so let's get started. Cat to the power minus one. Does it make sense to anybody? Is that some running gag? Is it some inside joke?
Was that Schrodinger's cat? Just
but why to the power minus one? I don't get that.
The minus one is an imaginary number.
Okay. I'm sure there's reasons. Okay. In fact, if I take your exams in midterms and I see how many people actually drew little owls and hares and tortoises, I might actually find out whose handwriting this is, okay. Whose drawing writing this is.
I know exactly who
it
is.
Yeah, who is it? Is it you?
Sebastian.
Really?
He's not in this
class. No, he's not in this class.
Sebastian.
You can just tell by the way.
Yeah.
Oh, you people know each other very, very well, I should say. Wow. Unbelievable. Okay, so let's get started. I think it's good to have a small recap of Lagrangian physics. Not do the whole thing all over again, of course, but you know, you have a system. By system, I mean a piece of nature. Typically can be described by something that has a position and something that has a velocity, and you want to know what this position is and what this velocity is, both of them as a function of time. You don't know those numbers or those functions, right? These are functions of time, both of them. And the whole idea of mechanics, Lagrangian or Newtonian, is to find out how do things move given circumstances. So the question is, how does x as a function of t look? How does v as a function of t look? And this is no new stuff. You know all of this. What you do is you construct this new thing that we call the action. You integrate your Lagrangian over time. That produces a number. And then in principle what you do is you look at all possible mathematical ways that you could have written x or v. And for all of them you calculate what this number s is, and you get this enormous amount of numbers s, and you pick that one s that is the smallest. The x and v that correspond to that number is what nature chooses to do. That was the whole idea of Lagrangian physics. Lagrangian physics, where the action is, I actually saw somewhere. Think about it for a while, there's a pun in there. Nobody? No? Okay, I thought it was hilarious.
Yeah.
Okay. Tough crowd today. Okay. So so that was the whole idea. Now, how do you find when this is smallest? And you might recall from last week's tutorial, it might also be the biggest. Why? Because you had complete freedom in putting numbers in front of Lagrangian without changing your physics. So, you know, might as well put a zero or a minus there, and your maximum would have been a minimum. So the only thing that you really care about is the extremized action. And the question then is, how do you find that path x and v that makes this action extremized? And you already know the answer. And if you don't know, ask Ahmad, because he's very happy to write it down for you on your respective whiteboards in the common room. Mm-hmm. You take your Lagrangian, you take its derivative with respect to x, then you take the Lagrangian derivative with respect to v, and of that thing you take the time derivative. And via our discussions of last week, you might remember that there's a really clear difference between these curly d's and the straight d's. You have to keep those things in mind. This is the correct way of writing this. And whatever comes out here, that will make this thing either biggest or smallest. We haven't proven that it is. And given enough time today, I will show you how that is done. Half of the people here have done quantum mechanics, yes? The course. All right. So I saw an email floating about, and Jaco said, some people need to practice with their Taylor series. Nobody? See this email? Yeah? So for that reason alone, we might actually spend some time doing this, because you need some version of Taylor series to prove that this is the case. If we have time, let's prove that. But it's just a mathematical statement. Okay, there's no physics going from extremizing this to getting this equation. It's just mathematics. So given time, we will prove that today. Now, and then something comes out. And this is what nature apparently does. Now, let's not go through the whole list of why Lagrangian physics is preferable over the other types of physics. But one thing I haven't really emphasized enough is that Lagrangian physics apparently is the rule that works for all of physics. We haven't found any physics yet that cannot be written in this way. So somebody would ask me, so what is the most important rule of physics? Is it the second law of thermodynamics? Is it the conservation of energy? Then I would say no, it's the maximization of Lagrangians or actions. I think that is the most important law of physics that we have at the moment. Because all of physics can be put in that way and comes with all kinds of bonuses. And you know the main bonus here, right, for our course, and that is that if you then take your Lagrangian and you write down this thing, that would give you something that we call the momentum. And if you take the Lagrangian and you would write down this thing, you'll get something that we call the energy. And we've shown under what conditions these things are conserved. Do you remember what the conditions are? When is this thing conserved?
No time dependence.
Of what?
Of no explicit time dependence.
No explicit time dependence, okay? Of course it has an implicit time dependence because X and V depend on time. Otherwise you're not, you're looking at a coffee cup which is standing still, okay? Which is a correct system in physics, it's just not very interesting. So conserved when L is not explicitly time dependent. Okay, how about this one? When is this one conserved? Certainly not always.
No time dependent and X dependent.
No time dependence?
No, explicitly time dependent too.
No. No, you don't care about the time dependence, though. At the moment that this is already zero, then everything will be. Oh, excuse me. No.
Both? No.
No, not really. As long as it's no explicitly X dependent, then this is zero, and you don't care about the time. The time dependence will be zero from that moment on.
But what if there was a time dependence?
That wouldn't change anything in the argument.
Okay, it will still be also zero.
Yeah, because we call this thing, right? This thing is what we will call P. And just saying that the DDT of that thing is zero is enough to say that P is constant, regardless of how the T's are within that P. So this is conserved when L is not explicitly X dependent. Now, I would like to go through our two prime examples of Lagrangians just one more time today. And then we're going to build on that information. But you all know this stuff, yes? This is not new. Now, there were two examples of this that we have looked at. One of them, and let's start with that one, was the Lagrangian that gives you Newtonian physics. Do you remember what that was? The Lagrangian that corresponds to basic Newtonian non-relativistic physics. Yeah. Yes, please.
Yeah. Half mv squared minus vx.
Yes. If you have this Lagrangian, then all these rules over there gave you interesting things. This thing, the Euler-Lagrange equation, gave you Newton's second law. And the energy thing gave you what you typically already in history call the energy of the thing. Now, a small comment that I've already made on Friday, but I'd like to emphasize it one more time. No, that does not mean that if somebody gives you a Lagrangian, just replace some minus sign in between by plus sign and you get the energy. Yes, it happens to be the case here. Certainly is not always true. All right, so that was one example that we looked at. You don't even have to prove anymore that this thing is time independent because we proved for the general case, and we did this on Friday. We actually did the time derivative of this thing. We saw, yes, it is indeed time independent. So that's the conservation of energy right there. All right, you know, before going to relativity, do you know what the energy is of an electromagnetic field? Have you seen this in electromagnetism? Sorry? The potential of the electromagnetic field.
So if there's a magnetic force attracting, then there's a potential.
Oh, but attracting what?
A charge.
I think you're thinking about a charge flying around in an electromagnetic field, and then you calculate what the energy is of that particle. That's not my question. My question is the energy of the electric and magnetic field itself, regardless of the particles floating around in the system. Yes, ultimately that's correct. You can have some, in order to get the magnetic field, you have to have some charged particles floating around.
So that thing
around.
Has a potential and that makes the field.
Yes, but it's all correct. But at the moment that you take that potential, you get the energy of that particle, which is a completely valid question. It's just not the question I'm asking. The question is, the electromagnetic field itself also has an energy. Do you know what that is? If you don't know it, it's fine.
Wait, isn't that one of Maxwell's equations, integral... One.
Yeah, go ahead.
I barely remember it. I think it equals to zero.
There should be a sum in there
the
as well.
Closed circular integral of the magnetic field should be.
Oh, no. You're talking about a different rule now.
Yeah.
You're talking about one of the integral forms of one of the Maxwell equations.
Yeah.
But that's not what I'm asking. Yes.
Should be a B.
Well, there is a B in there, yes. You get the you need a magnetic field to make an energy, yes. It's the electric field squared plus the magnetic field squared. And there are some numbers in front that physicists typically set to one. And I think it's these are the numbers. Anyway. Now how do you get this? In exactly the same way as you got this, namely via this. Alright? So if I would give you the Lagrangian for the electromagnetic field. Forget about the particles within an electromagnetic field. It just gives the Lagrangian of the electromagnetic field. And you go through the same steps here, you get everything that you want to know. So I was just curious if somebody had seen this in their electromagnetism course, where I guess expressions like these just drop out of the sky or something like that.
Yeah.
You can prove it in the same way. The reason that I bring this up is not to tell you something about electromagnetic fields, but because if I would have just stuck to this part, you might have gotten the impression that Lagrangian physics only works when you look at things that have masses. Okay? It doesn't. There are also Lagrangians for things that do not have mass. Or Lagrangians that simply cannot be written as kinetic minus potential energy. I mean, what the hell is the kinetic energy of an electromagnetic field? No idea. But I can still write down the Lagrangian. One final comment why I want to connect these things to each other. That is... If you look at physics without knowing too much about this, then you know that in classical physics, in classical mechanics, you have a thing called the energy. And somebody taught you probably that it was this thing. And maybe you knew from your classical electromagnetism that this was the energy of the electromagnetic field. Now you also know that there is a conservation of energy. So that means that in principle, you can take some of this energy and put it into here. Right? These are your particles in the electromagnetic field that you accelerate. Mm-hmm. So you steal a little bit of the energy from the electromagnetic field and put it in the masses. Now, but note that I'm sort of doing a strange step over there, because I started with this thing that I call energy, that thing that I call energy, and then I just plainly said that whatever this energy is can be transferred into this energy. Now, how do you prove that in the first place?
You have to find a gradient that bears both, kind of.
Mm-hmm.
We have to create a new gradient that take in consideration like both energy.
So you're talking something about like this, right? You have to change the potential energy that in principle gives you forces.
Yeah, and you like the function, the Vx function, the Lagrangian, you need to transform it so that when one is like. Yeah, so basically, so we can like switch between one and two, so we need a higher, like a different Lagrangian.
Yes, exactly. That's what I was looking for. I don't necessarily need the gradient part. But the point that I try to make here is that, yes, you know what expressions are for energy in one piece of physics. You know what expressions are for energy in one other piece of physics. You also know that apparently you can take this amount, this thing that's called energy, that thing that's called energy, and transfer some values back and forth. But that by itself is not trivial. Right? If I give you Newton's laws and I give you Maxwell's equations, show me that an amount of energy that comes from the Maxwell equations goes into Newton's laws. That is a non-trivial question, how to do that.
You have a global kind of Lagrangian that works for all the energy we have.
Yes, exactly.
So let's use that one.
Exactly. And that was your point before. And that's my point that I try to make now. that you shouldn't not see, you should not see physics as in, well, you have this island here of physics that we call mechanics, and it has its own sets of rules. This is the energy, this is the rule that it obeys. You have this other island in physics that has a expression for energy, that's this one, and these rules that it obeys, those are the Maxwell equations, and see them as separate entities. You can write down Lagrangians that combines everything together.
So what is the name of the, like, how is it written? Because, like, if we only need to learn that.
Well, it depends how far you want to go. There is the Lagrangian that we have, the biggest Lagrangian that we have, is called the Lagrangian of the standard model. For the people who've done the particle physics course, I think Jacob's handed out mugs that has this Lagrangian on it. Okay. And it depends on how many interactions between different things you want to take into account.
Yeah, so.
And
I guess the more
interactions between things, the bigger it becomes.
But can we do it, like, is it are there limitation, or is it just a general form that we can, like,
in principle,
it just say, oh, you can add as many interactions as one.
Yes.
It's just like solving it is really difficult.
That's all that it is. So what particle physics or theoretical physics, let's not stick to particle physics per se. What theoretical physicists do, if you want to find the general rules of physics, including all their interactions, is they write down the Lagrangian, the biggest one that they can think of, and they just, with like Lego blocks, stack on top of that extra interactions.
But why do we learn then into different...
Why do you learn the islands first and not the whole ocean? Yeah?
Yeah.
So we can blow our minds later.
I guess so. I mean, well, yes, we would like to save the best for last, but there is another reason, that is that it is much more easy to first learn about energies and these sorts of things in one context and then learn it in the other context. I mean, suppose that you had to learn Newtonian physics. At the same time, you also had to learn about electromagnetism, because the principle, they are related in some way. It just becomes too difficult. So,
but we don't have to think in terms of Newtonian and, like...
No, I agree.
Then.
No, if we would started with 15-year-olds and just teaching them this, then we would have, you know, would be less step to make later. I agree. Yes.
For the electromagnetism equation, what are you integrating with respect to?
Oh, this is space. It's the amount of energy within a piece of space,
okay.
Cube of space or so.
And for mu zero, is that the permittivity?
This is the permittivity of vacuum for the
yes.
Anyway, the bigger point that I just wanted to make here is that you, with Lagrangian physics, it's very easy to connect islands of physics to each other and their mutual interactions, which is much more difficult if you just stick to Maxwell's equations here and Newton's equations over there and then hope that you find the connection. So, yes.
I remember you saying something that you cannot describe thermodynamics by means of Lagrangians, or at least parts of it.
Oh, that's the entropy question again, is it?
Yes.
Yes.
So that wouldn't come into the standard model of Lagrangian, would it?
No, it's an emergent thing. That was the point that I never specified in full. But thermodynamics is an emergent phenomenon. So if you know how things work on a microscopic level, then at a macroscopic level, pops out the rules of thermodynamics. And the entropy thing is a very special one, but again, I'm very, just like last week, I'm very tempted to tell you how that works.
So
it takes a little bit too long, I think, but yes.
The law of thermodynamics comes from quantum mechanics?
Yes. Yes and no. It depends on what rule you want to look at, okay?
The second law of thermodynamics?
Second law of thermodynamics, if you will, yes, comes from quantum mechanics. Yes. There's a huge connection there that I'm really tempting to make, but then I will have to skip the stuff that I actually want to or have to talk about today. But let me just very briefly say, and then I'll move on. Yeah, I cannot help myself. Okay. So there's four laws of thermodynamics. Yes, zeroth law, first law, second law, third law. Now the first law, I'm not doing it justice, but one phrasing of the first law is the conservation of energy. That's not quite all that it says. It says many more things. But okay, let's stick to the superficial way of saying it's conservation of energy. As you see, you don't even need any quantum mechanics there, yeah? If you have a Lagrangian and you make sure that it's explicitly time independent, then it will be a conserved system. It will have a conserved energy. Note, again, that at this point I haven't specified what's in the system. I haven't specified whether it is thermodynamics or electromagnetism or whatever. So whatever comes out is true for all, or a combined thing. Multiple pieces of physics connected together. As long as it's explicitly time independent, you will have in conserved energy. So if you will, that gives you the first law of thermodynamics. Do you know what the zeroth law of thermodynamics is?
When the two systems are in the same, are in thermal equilibrium, then the exchange of energy will be constant.
Yes, that is very true. And you can prove that by statistical means. So, too much of a tangent, but if you take two systems, indeed, if you take two systems and they're thermal equilibrium, by the way, what is thermal equilibrium? What
same
does that
temperature.
Mean?
Or the same exchange of heat.
There's no heat exchange between them. There's no heat exchange between them. Or the net heat exchange between them is
zero. Zero, yeah.
They vary the same way, I guess. That
same temperature.
I'm pretty sure it's
if one,
it gives you a difficult question, namely, what do you mean by temperature in the first place? What is temperature?
It's a measure of energy.
Yes, but no. That is sometimes true. That is not always true.
Heat.
If you think about systems consisting of vibrating particles, yes, then it's a measure of the average kinetic energy of the particles within that system. If you have a system that does not consist of particles, you cannot use that rule. Then temperature comes with a different, bigger definition.
Precious. If we make a small variation in one, the same variation will follow in this, like the other one. Like that could be. We can find a similarity, like in the variation in one system.
Yes.
Like you must have an equivalent like variation in the other one, something like that.
Yeah, I hear the words, but I don't know what they mean. An equivalent variation.
That's if you. If there is a change in one system, then the system is equilibrium with the other one, and another change must happen in the second one to compensate for the other one.
That's actually pretty close. Now I really have to get off this tangent because I have to go back to my original stuff. But thermodynamics is such a cool subject. If you look at a system and you do introduce quantum mechanics, then you know that there are energy levels in there, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that means that if you take a constituent of your system, and a constituent could be a particle, but it could also be a photon, whatever the system is made of, doesn't necessarily have to be massive particles, and you know your quantum mechanics, you can calculate what the energy levels are. And what you can then next do by statistical means is, suppose that I have all these energy levels that I pre-calculated, I put my constituents, could be a big ball of electrons that I've pour over my energy levels, and then I calculate which configuration of these constituents over the energy levels has the biggest probability of happening. That's a statistical question. Then you can find that the outcome that has the biggest probability is the one that we associate with the biggest entropy. Now, that gives you the second law of thermodynamics. It's by statistical means, things will redistribute themselves over energy levels in such a way that what we then call entropy has the biggest value. That gives you the second law. Zeroth law, that was yours.
Biggest
if you
or
have,
smallest?
Sorry?
Biggest or smallest?
Biggest.
Biggest entropy.
Positive entropy. Variation of entropy.
Now, what you can also do is that you have two of these systems which both come with their energy levels, and you pour out your constituents, particles, photons, whatever it is, and you let them redistribute themselves over themselves. These two particles, when they connect with each other, and you do the statistics on that, you will find that they redistribute themselves in such a way that indeed they will come out with the same temperature. So the zeroth law, again, is a statistical result. Now, and then there's a third law that says that you cannot go to absolute zero in a finite amount of steps. That almost automatically falls from quantum mechanics. Because you need quantum mechanics. Well, quantum mechanics tells you you cannot have particles or constituents all at the same place. Excuse me, not at the same place. That's not necessary. But, that you know with 100% accuracy where they are and how much they are moving. That's against Heisenberg. So you'll always end up with a certain amount of energy that you cannot do away with. That gives you the zero, the third law. Now, so for three of these laws, you need quantum mechanics. Because two of the two laws, the zeroth and the second, you need energy levels. Those you get from quantum mechanics. The first law, again, in a very superficial way put, is the conservation of energy. It says more than that, but let's stick to this one now. You just need a Lagrangian that's not explicitly time-dependent. Third law, you need Heisenberg. There you go, all of thermodynamics, quantum mechanics, and your Lagrangian physics. So, anyway, enough tangent. Back to here. again, power of Lagrangians is the whole point here. There was one example, yes, our classical, Newtonian classical one. Do you remember? So, our second example, the one that we are going to concern ourselves with today.
Minus MC squared over C gamma. Squared over
yes.
Sigma.
That is fine.
Gamma.
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 Yes. At some point, Vladimir, during throughout this course, you will not confuse sigmas and gammas anymore. No, you mean well. It's his nomenclature, of course, but the thing is called gamma. Now, the way that we originally did it was we wrote it as such because this one was invariant, yes? We got this from the Minkowski line element. Is this okay still?
Yeah.
Okay. Can you give me a reason why that's okay, putting a minus sign there?
We demonstrated, like in a course, a previous example.
Yeah, exactly.
It just it doesn't change the action.
Exactly. It does change the action, but it does not change the outcome of the Euler-Lagrange equation. It gives you the same laws of physics. So the minus sign is okay. How about this? Is this okay still?
Yeah.
Okay, there's two reasons, yes? One of them is, again, we've proved on Friday that you can multiply with whatever number that you want. Again, it doesn't change Euler-Lagrange equations. But the numbers that you have to multiply with have to be constant, because otherwise your derivatives will give you new extra effects that you don't want. So that's one. And the second reason why this is okay is because of invariance. It doesn't break invariance. You remember this, yes?
Yep.
You multiply with something that is invariant, and you multiply with something that is invariant squared. So this thing is still invariant. Why do we multiply the 1 over gamma by minus mc squared? We're free to do it, but why would we? Yes, units. We wanted to come out in energy. Well, we wanted to connect it to what we already knew from Newton, what we called energy in Newtonian physics, yes.
Mm-hmm.
So we took the freedom to make this choice to make it connect better to classical physics. Laws of physics still the same, just put a different label on these things. Now, do you remember what the energy was that came out? Oh, no, let's start here. Do you remember what the Euler-Lagrange equations tell you? How does this thing move through space, this mass?
Yeah. Acceleration is zero.
Yes, we found that this is zero. By the way, is this an invariant statement that acceleration is zero under this Lagrangian? Is it invariant?
Yeah. No, because the gamma is changing the.
Right. Well, if you go to another, but that's rephrasing of the same question. If you go to some other inertial system, will you still find that acceleration is zero?
Yes.
Why?
Because acceleration is objective.
Okay.
Like as we said,
velocity changes
as we change the reference of frame, but acceleration, everyone will agree
okay.
that.
Okay, I needed a moment to understand what you meant by objective, but you mean that if you go from one inertial system to the next, you cannot end up with extra acceleration or decrease acceleration. That's correct. Okay, that is correct.
Okay.
But maybe, no, that's correct, yes. But also, I guess it's the same. It's another way of saying the same thing. Acceleration in some guy's frame is this thing, yeah?
Yep.
Now your x might change, or your dx might change from one system to the next.
Mm-hmm.
But it can only change by a factor of gamma, agreed?
Mm-hmm.
Because that's Lorentz contraction. And here's an amount of time squared. And that also changed from one system to the next. So that gives you some more gammas, maybe. But all these gammas are going to be multiplied or have to end up with zero. So apparently the acceleration in some other guy's system is still zero. That's really just a restatement of what I'm saying here. So there's no Lorentz contraction or time dilation that makes this come out non-zero. So yeah, this is an invariant statement. So apparently, under this Lagrangian things, in Minkowski space-time, and special relativity will still go via Newton's first law. And so that came out of this. Do you remember what the energy was that came out of this?
Gamma mc squared.
Gamma mc squared, or if you will, if you play around with the definition of the relativistic momentum, you can also write this. That's an equivalent statement. These two things give you the same information, but not quite, because this gives you a plus value and a minus value for E, and this only gives you a plus value. Okay? So this is what you get out from Lagrangian physics. If you square it, You're smuggling in a possible minus solution. And we talked about that.
Yeah.
That gives you antiparticles if you interpret them in the right way. Let's stick to this expression for a moment. Now, the fact. So this is we've all seen this before. This is conserved in time. Well, why? Because we proved that it's always conserved in time if the Lagrangian is not explicitly time dependent, so this one should be as well. If you want to take its actual time derivative of this thing, and you will see because of the V that's within the gamma, this will always have an overall factor of A, which is zero, so therefore energy is indeed conserved. But all of this only corresponds to things moving with a constant velocity, yes? So it's fine, we got good results, but it's not the most general thing we can look at. Now, when I say general, I don't mean general relativity. General relativity is when you go, you yourself go to a non-inertial system. That's not what I mean. I'm not talking about you starting to accelerate. I'm talking about the thing that you look at starting to accelerate. And this thing will not do, because look, apparently, if you just go through the math, you find that this is a constant velocity thing that you're looking at. So the question that we have to do today is, okay, how can we make this a system in which particles accelerate? How do we build this in? Now, I'm going to show you in a moment, but I'm just curious if somebody has maybe some idea on how to do that. So the question is, this Lagrangian that we have here, that we got from the principle of invariance, gave us, apparently, how masses move if they move with a constant velocity and what their energies are as such. Question, how can we play around with this mathematics such that what we get out will also incorporate things that have an acceleration? Just curious if somebody has an idea. If not, I will show you, of course.
Well, we don't have the least action anymore. So this S is not smallest slash biggest, I think.
Why don't we have the least action thing? I don't understand that.
Because then you will get acceleration to zero if you put in the Euler Lagrange equation.
No, you just have to change the L.
I'm not sure about the point yet.
What
you're
I'm
saying
trying to
that
say is if you keep adding things that are invariant,
yes,
to the Lagrangian,
yes,
then we will never reach an acceleration.
I'm curious about that. That is true, but I'm curious how you see it at this level.
Because if you add invariant things to an invariant system,
yes,
then you will never get acceleration, right?
I'm not sure, yeah, but I don't understand that exact step. It sounds like a non sequitur to me, unless there's something that you see that I don't. But no, you might be right.
It's very logical to me. If you have an invariant system and you add invariant things, then acceleration will remain zero because any reference frame you look at it, it will not have acceleration.
Oh.
Because you keep adding invariant things.
Yeah, but there's two things that could have an acceleration here. It could be you.
Mm-hmm.
And us adding invariant things just means that we ourselves stick to an inertial frame that has no bearing on whether the thing that you're looking at accelerates.
Okay.
So your statement is, as long as you add invariant things, you yourself will not accelerate. No, that is very true, I think. But maybe these two things are related. I have to think about this for a while. There might be something in there. Because it turns out that your conclusion is going to be correct. Maybe some other idea on how to do this. How do we build in that things can accelerate?
Well, in classical mechanics, you would just, like, when you write down the equation, you would have, like, V by T, and if you want to build in the acceleration, you would have, like, T squared.
If it is a constant acceleration, yes.
So
but we already ran into trouble. Whose T are you talking about here? Some
yeah,
guys
yeah.
T squared.
I mean, I would expect just an extra term in the Lagrangian and then like an extra dependence term.
An acceleration dependence term?
Well, we have to add something to the Lagrangian. I agree with that. We can get some hint on how to do this. I think by looking at this one just for a moment more. Now, do you remember what we did? I'm just going to write down the same thing here for a moment. Do you remember that last week when we did our quick and dirty way?
Yeah.
we could rewrite this if you go to things that don't move too fast with respect to you, like Taylor series. Let me write down one more time what that, what happens then. This is when V is very small compared to C. So that thinks the thing that you're looking at does not move too fast. Then here, 1 over the root is the same thing as this thing to the power of minus 1/2. And then you can use that Taylor series thing again, yeah? Now convince yourself that what I'm writing down now is correct. You get this. For people who need this. The cat is not far of the formula. And here n is minus 1/2 and such. And then you write this out, and you get mc squared plus 1/2 mv squared. And this is how, when we did our quick and dirty way, we concluded that this thing apparently had to be in energy. Because it gave you kinetic energy in case you went back to Newtonian physics. Now, kinetic energy, what would then this be? If this is, if we're now in back in Newtonian physics, yeah? We got there via a different way, we got there via relativity. But because we made V very small compared to C, we should get back Newtonian physics. In Newtonian physics, you know that energies of particles that float around are given by kinetic
plus potential.
So apparently, this is apparently the potential energy of a particle that is otherwise left alone. That was a statement that I made last time. It's the amount of energy that particles will always have if they have mass. This amount you can play around with. If you walk along with a particle such that it will have a relative velocity of zero with respect to you, then this is zero, but you can never do away with this part.
Mm-hmm.
So particles will always have, at the very minimum, an amount of energy mc squared. And yes, in Newtonian physics, just to make the correspondence, this must be your potential energy then.
Yep.
Now, we talked about this last week. It does not do any good in Newtonian physics because it's just a constant amount. And you know that constant amount is just shifting your energy, the amount of energy, right, where your zero point of the energy is, and energy differences, the thing that actually gives you physics, is not changed. Remember this, yes? So this is, yes, you can identify this as the potential energy, but it has no bearing on what you would measure if you would do your physics, if you measure how fast things are moving as such, and you do your Newtonian mechanics. By the way, this relates also to what we did on Friday, when we discussed that you can actually add numbers to Lagrangians if they are constant, without changing anything. We see the same thing back here. Okay, so everything is connecting well together. Let's go to the Lagrangian for a moment. Okay?
Oh.
And let's take the Lagrangian. And let's also take this relativistic Lagrangian and make it in the Newtonian regime. Again, look at V very much smaller than C.
You have to need a dependence of X for kind of the force or the field of the acceleration that one can have.
Yes.
And then, but then we won't have, like, it won't be no more independence.
I know. No, you're taking away my next 30 minutes, but you're right. It's good. You see everything happening. So I hope people will pick up, right? It is exactly correct. Oh, Jort, such a popular guy, yeah. So no, you're right. That's exactly going to be my conclusion in a moment. Now, let's go to Lagrangian, yes? This is our Lagrangian that we derived, or that we postulated by means of it having to be invariant. And let's do the same, let's go back to Newtonian physics again by taking V very much smaller than C. So here's the same Taylor series again. You will get 1 minus 1/2 over Vc squared. Do you agree with this part? Same approximation. Do you also see why this is still a minus and did not turn into a plus? Because it was 1 over gamma, gamma here, 1 over a square root. Here it is a square root, so that drops a minus sign somewhere in this Taylor series. You'll get this. Let's write that out. You will get this. So apparently, if you take your relativistic Lagrangian and you go back to Newtonian physics, you get kinetic energy minus mc squared. Now, what should Lagrangians be in Newtonian physics?
T minus U.
Exactly, kinetic minus potential. So do you see that again we see here a reason to identify this thing as the potential energy? It happens both in the actual energy expressions and in the Lagrangian expression. Okay? So that should give you confidence that this thing, our original, really is the kinetic energy with a little bit of extra potential. Now we're going to go to accelerating particles. Particles only accelerate if they are in a field, in a potential energy field, an x-dependent potential energy field. And apparently, just from looking at this, by going back to Newtonian physics, you see that you can just take this thing as kinetic energy. So how do you make that thing into a Lagrangian that also includes acceleration? So
at
say,
x-dependence?
Minus an x-dependence. Exactly. Now, if you're not seeing this point, it's extremely important. We are this thing. We saw both on the Lagrangian level and in the energy level, there's a joke in there somewhere if you think about it, on the level of energies and such, you will find that this thing is a kinetic energy minus a constant amount, which we call potential energy. So apparently what we find here is that you can treat this thing in exactly the same way as you would in Newtonian physics. If you want to know how things move, if they accelerate, subtract potential energy. Okay? One more time. We've identified this as kinetic energy minus a potential term. Then the energy came out as kinetic energy plus a potential term. We know how to do extra energies, potential energies in Newtonian physics. You should just subtract it from the Lagrangian, so apparently you're also allowed to do it here. Yes?
So if you have a force, then the change in momentum is not going to be zero anymore.
Yes,
right?
And that was in fact Vladimir's point, because he mentioned just a second ago, but it's not exactly your point, but it's close to his point. Yes,
so
you will
if
not.
If you add x dependence,
yes,
then B is not going to change.
Very much agreed. We saw last week that your momentum is also only going to be conserved at the moment that your Lagrangian is not x-dependent. But in order to make things accelerate, we have now concluded you have to subtract an x-dependent thing. Mm-hmm. So that means that apparently this thing will not hold anymore. Well, the expression will still hold, but it will not be conserved in time. But that's not surprising, because already in Newtonian physics, if you start pushing at things, they will increase your momentum, yeah? So of course momentum is not going to be conserved, because by construction we're adding forces. So that it makes all the sense in the world. So, long story short, the point that I'm making here is we identify this thing as kinetic. We've seen that it works exactly the same way as it would in Newtonian physics, so therefore we can just use the same trick, subtract the potential energy. And now we come to Vladimir's point, I think, but you have to, I'm paraphrasing, so if I'm not going to say exactly what you meant, please correct me. So we're going to subtract from this potential energy. And yes, that means it will be x-dependent, and therefore your Lagrangian will be explicitly x-dependent. Mm-hmm. And therefore you will not have conserved momentum. No surprises there. You start pushing again things, of course the momentum is going to change. But here's a bigger point. Is it still invariant? This part was invariant. But now you subtract something that depends on x. Will that be invariant? Well, your x is not going to be invariant, are they?
No. But the proper length, I mean...
That is a good point. You might, in a very contrived way, come up with a potential energy that does depend on x, and x is, in principle, is coordinate system dependent, inertial system dependent, but the way that the potential energy looks will counteract that, and this thing will still come out invariant. That might still be the case, but in general, you will see that if you do this, you will lose your invariance. Again, unless your potential energy happens to be of a very specific form. Mm-hmm. In fact, we already had an example of this, because look, this thing is V dependent, this part, yeah? Mm-hmm. And you think, oh, but V is inertial system dependent. Yet, yes, but this thing still gave ultimately an invariant action. So just the fact that it depends on V is not enough to say that it's not invariant. And in very much the same way, just the fact that this depends on X is not saying that it will thus be necessarily invariant. It might still be invariant if you, in a very contrived way, but generally you lose your invariance. But then again, that's what we have to do.
Yep.
So, everybody clear on this? We're going to make our physics bigger by subtracting potential energies now.
Just a question.
Yes.
On the polynomial Taylor thing.
Yes.
Are we allowed to use it, since normally we are going to be on very close speed of, very close to the speed of light, so we'll be close to one, no? So are we allowed to use it?
In what context do you mean? I use it here too.
Yeah, here.
Yes.
But I'm just like, I thought that it only we could make that approximation only if, like, we suppose that the terms are really small.
Yes.
But then if we are very close to the speed of light, wouldn't it be a problem, because then we'll be very close to 1? No?
Yeah, then your Lagrangian loop becomes 0 ultimately.
Oh yeah, because it's 1,
yes.
Oh, it's the overall thing that needs to be very close to.
Yes.
Okay, so we couldn't do it if we were at the speed were really low, actually.
No.
Okay.
In fact, that's another suggestion, that apparently some strange things happen when you go to the speed of light. Your Lagrangian would be 0, and it's hard to do physics with 0. I mean, you can put 0 into your Lagrangian if you're 0, 0, which is correct, but it's hard to do physics with it. Okay, so. Here's the thing. We are going to go through the same series of steps. But now with our Lagrangian that we now know how to put in accelerations. Here's our relativistic Lagrangian again. There we go. So I'm dropping this whole things do not move slow compared with the speed of light thing or so. This is just a general case again. Okay, and we've now seen you have to subtract this thing. Where does that come from? Well, it could be Newtonian physics. Could be something else. Somebody told you what the potential energy field is. Now, what should we do first? Calculate the energy or calculate how things move? There's two things we can do, yeah? We can calculate this and we can calculate that. Well, both we have to do. Which one do you want to start with?
Maybe the first one.
This one? I will give you the answer. So, if you do the Euler Lagrange, and this is something I want you to do during the tutorial, to actually go through the maths. So, how can you make the action minimized or maximized? You will find that there you go. You get Newton's second law, but with an extra power to the 3. Now, putting this here into here and getting this is exactly your exercise for later, yeah? But this one will come out. Now, let's linger here for just a moment. Yes, please.
My only question is, mm-hmm. but you would get the same formula for a force if you didn't have the potential energy element, right? Because if you take the normal Lagrangian that we used up until now,
mm-hmm.
and you take it in the momentum, and then you take the time derivative of the momentum,
yes.
which is the definition of a force, you get gamma.
Yes. That was your trick of a week ago, I think that it was, or 2 weeks ago or so. Yeah, that also works. Remember, last week we also got to, well, not the Lagrangian part, but we got to an energy expression and I think also momentum expression, right, by doing this quick and dirty way. And then Shinai came up with the idea, well, if you take the time derivative, that by definition then should be force. So if you want, you can extend our quick and dirty way of last week and also get this expression. That works just as well. Now, I want to linger here for a moment because it has some extremely important consequences. Claim. Let's see if you see why. This mass will never go faster than the speed of light by this expression. Can you tell why? I'll give you a moment to think about that one. We have Newton's second law in relativity now. Apparently you get a gamma to the 3 extra. Claim.
You cannot divide by 0.
Yeah.
You cannot divide by 0.
Well, if it's greater, the square root of minus.
So if V would be C, then gamma would be what?
Wouldn't it be one by zero?
Infinite.
Infinite.
It would
be
infinite.
Force.
Yes.
Yeah.
What was it, what does that mean? I mean, I mathematically understand what you mean. That if V becomes zero, or it becomes C, then this thing, gamma will go to infinity.
Yeah.
Okay. But how does that tell you that you cannot go faster than speed of light? That part is not clear.
Well,
to
then
me.
The force would be infinite.
Yeah.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah.
Okay. So the force. So what does that mean? Yeah, sorry, Tom, you're in the way. Right. If you go, if something is going with the speed of light, then gamma will be infinity. So therefore you say, oh, but then the force is infinity. First of all, I'm not sure that that is true. Because A will go to zero, maybe. And then you have an infinity times zero, and I have no idea what that is.
Yeah, it will still be weird, right?
Can
we test just taking gamma to the cube and try to see what happens if we take the limits of that when V tend to C?
Okay, that would be a better way of doing it.
And then we'll see what happens, and if it's infinite when it tends to C, then we cannot go.
I agree with that. In fact, that will be a somewhat more sophisticated way of taking Ash's comment. Namely, but let's repeat for a moment here. If things would go with the speed of light, gamma becomes infinity. So therefore you say, oh, force becomes infinity. Now, first of all, I don't see an issue there per se. Okay, force becomes infinity, so what? I mean, secondly, you cannot say whether if this becomes infinity, gamma, F will become infinity, because you don't know what A is doing. If this one goes up and this one goes down, and they go up and down with a certain amount such, you could still have something finite that comes out.
Yeah.
But that means you cannot accelerate anymore if you go at the speed of light. So you cannot go faster.
Oh, well, here's something interesting. All right, let's go there for a moment. Oh, there was a last comment that I think that just putting this to C of V to C by itself, I don't think is a complete argument, because then you're skipping the part where you are trying to get to V is C, yes? The whole getting there part you're skipping.
We can do it as the opposite. So we make it, we suppose that C is the limit, and we validate to see if C is the limit or not. So we make delta gamma minus MA and minus C, and then we take the limits of V when it tends to infinite, and then it will see that if it's correct,
yes.
Then C will be the limit. If we are able to prove that, then C will be the limit of our like.
No, that's correct.
And then whatever happens, like we take in consideration the acceleration too.
No, that's good. That's good, because what you're now doing, you're mathematically circumventing this issue that you also have to check what A is doing while gamma is going to infinity. Yeah, it's a puristic thing, but it is. You have to check these things. You cannot just say A times B. Where A goes to infinity, therefore the outcome will go to infinity.
So
no, if B goes to zero, you still don't know what happens.
So we can suppose, like beforehand, that
yes.
C is the limit, and just like by definition of the limit, subtract it and see if we can make it as small as possible, like the theta as small as possible.
I see. You're actually taking the mathematical definition of a limit and find out what happens. Yes. Or if you want, you can also use L'Hopital's rule. For the people who know what I'm talking about, right? If you have an expression and you want to see what happens when you take a certain limit and it comes out as 0 over 0 or infinity over infinity, and you want to know what the limit is, you can take the derivative of denominator and numerator and see what its limit is. That is the same limit. That's L'Hopital's rule from calculus. Now, here's another trick. I'm sure that will work, by the way. Here's another trick. I just rewrote the law in this way. A is F over N to the gamma 3. Now, do you agree with me that if you reach the highest velocity, whatever the number is, I don't know that whether it's C or not, you reach the highest velocity, what will A be by definition of highest velocity?
Zero.
The
highest zero.
Yes.
The acceleration is zero.
Then the acceleration is zero. By definition, just as a calculus thing. The highest point of a function is when its derivative is zero.
Yeah, we suppose that there is a highest point.
I agree, but we will check whether that's the case. So, highest velocity, is by definition that A is zero, yes? This is when you reach the highest velocity. Let's check when that happens. This part is F over M. And gamma to the 3, 1 over gamma to the 3 is 1 minus V over C squared to the power 3 over 2. I ask a question again. When is this 0? For what V will this become 0? Do you see that this law is just this? No approximations there whatsoever, okay? Now, highest velocity is when A is 0, agreed?
Yep.
That's just a calculus thing, it's not even physics. Question, highest velocity then by definition is when the outcome of this thing is 0. Question, at what V does that happen?
C.
V is C.
Wait, wasn't it?
Conclusion, the highest velocity
yeah.
you will get, you can obtain, is when V is C. Here's an actual proof based on physics. Note, question to you, does it matter what V was, or what F was, how much pushing you've done?
No.
Do you see that this will come out zero regardless of your function of F?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? So apparently, it doesn't matter how much pushing you do, this thing will always kick it to zero.
But why doesn't... I don't see the argument when you say that it doesn't depend on F. If F increases like more rapidly
yeah.
than V of C.
Yeah, but as soon as V becomes C, then it's zero, so F doesn't matter anymore.
Yes.
Yeah.
Unless
if
F
the F is infinite, for example, like if it
yes.
tends to, there is no limit.
That's
either
a good point.
To F.
That's a good point. Let's specify a little bit more in a moment, okay? I will say this though. Your F here, as long as it does not become infinite, you're not doing infinite amount of pushing. You can do a big amount of pushing. You can even do an increased amount of pushing, but you will not push so hard that acceleration is not zero anymore at VSC. Okay? But yes, there is a mathematical caveat there. What if the smallness of this part is counteracted by the bigness of F?
Yeah.
Now the only way to do that consistently is whatever F is, it will has to be V dependent.
Oh, yeah.
Do you see that? Why that is true? Because you always have to counteract this thing is V dependent.
Yeah, yeah.
Now can you name a force that is V dependent?
Friction.
Friction is a good one. But does friction make things increase or decrease?
Decrease.
Friction decreases velocities.
Magnetic.
Magnetic.
Yeah, the magnetic force.
Oh, the Lorentz force.
Yeah, yeah
that
exactly.
Is, oh, yeah, that is a very good one.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a very good one. Because the Lorentz force,
increases
what you're saying,
with a higher velocity.
Is V
no,
B.
Increases.
Something like this, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, but I think something else will happen there. I have to think about it a little bit more. But I think something, I can think of two reasons why it still would not work. One of them, well, I can think of three reasons, in fact. Okay, I'm just going to throw it out there. Let's see if any of them hold water. First of all, the force here, because of the outer product, will work perpendicular to its direction of motion.
Indeed.
Whereas this law is only in the direction of motion. So that means that the increase of F will not help or will not be in the same direction as the acceleration is.
Yeah.
So that means that they cannot counteract each other. That's one reason. Second reason is Lenz's law, that you might know from electromagnetism, that magnetic fields always orient themselves in such a way that it tend to decrease.
Yeah.
Okay? It's a direct result of induction. And there's a third reason. Damn it, that was the most important one that just came up and all of a sudden got lost again. No, I honestly don't know what my third reason was. It was the best of the three, I remember. That probably means I need some coffee. Anyway, let's have a break. I will show you in a moment one more reason why you cannot go fast, masses cannot go fast in speed of light. We've now done it based on forces, okay? I will show you in a moment, you can also conclude the same thing based on energies. But that will come after the break. All right, and I'll think about the third reason that for some reason slipped my mind. But it was a beauty. All right, I'll be back in 15...
right now?
Minutes.
Okay, now you're putting pressure on me.
Okay, there we go. So we were doing some freewheeling during the break, as you can tell by the board. So let's see if we can make some sense out of it still. The point that we made, my God, it's going to be so difficult to point things out. So the point that we made here was that, I should just write it again, I think. That we found this law. That this, you got this, yes? And what we did, the argumentation was, okay, well, you have A, then must be equal to F over M gamma to the 3, which is the same as F over M 1 minus V over C squared to the power 3, 2. We got this. And the argument that we were making before the break was, well, the highest velocity you attain at the moment that your acceleration is zero, by definition of acceleration, if you will. Now, when do you can you make this thing, the acceleration, zero? Well, if you make sure that this thing is zero. And when is that zero? When V is C. Conclusion, apparently, whatever you do, in other words, whatever your F was, could be a number, could be a function, but it will always be put to zero by this additional factor at the moment that V becomes C. Okay, that was the argumentation before. Therefore, no matter how much pushing you do, things will not go faster than the speed of light. That was the argumentation. Now, we are freewheeling a little bit. Okay, well, maybe we can think of counterexamples. What if, that was the idea, the F becomes bigger, then this part becomes smaller. They counteract each other. Then I said, well, then at the very least, the thing should be V dependent. Remember that argument? And then somebody said, ah, I know a V dependent force, friction. And I said, aha, but friction counteracts acceleration upward, yes? Okay, it's correct. Then somebody else said, okay, but what about the Lorentz force? And then I said, aha, but that one, that force, is in a different direction, it's perpendicular to the direction that you're, so it doesn't help in accelerating towards the speed of light or beyond. And then we had a number of other reasons. Can you remind me again? Literally blanking again.
It's the normal vector. One of the reasons was that in the Lorentz force, it's the normal vector. Is that what you're asking?
I don't think so.
Okay.
No.
Never mind.
You come up with a couple of reasons.
So,
yes, help me, yes.
That charge and magnetic field is also...
That was for that particular one. Okay, well, what I didn't like, and I was thinking about it during the break with some students, is that in order to make that counter-argument, you needed to have the explicit form of this particular function, yes? This force. Nature has told us that it is this, and under this particular circumstance, I can find a counterexample. In this case, the perpendicularity of the thing. But in principle, there's nothing wrong with saying, "Well, there might be a force that is a function of V that does indeed counteract this." Now, two additional reasons we think that that will probably not be the case. One of them, Robert, wasn't you who came up with this? Because then I have a name for this new rule. Yes, okay, so I'm going to call this the Nathan rule. She came up with a beautiful idea as follows. She said, okay, suppose indeed that F is in such a way that it counteracts this second factor, yes? Now my point then was, we talked about this during the break, that at the very least an F should be proportional to gamma 2 to 3. It might be something else as well, X dependent, V dependent, what have you. But at the very least it should be gamma 2 to 3, because as a counteract, this gamma 2 to 3.
Yeah.
And only in that way can they cancel each other out. And then here comes the Nathan rule. Robin said, well, okay, but even if you would have an F that happens to have this particular way, this particular form, then still getting V over C will result in this part being imaginary. Do you see that happening? Okay, but that means that the force apparently becomes imaginary. If V becomes bigger than C.
So why does it become imaginary?
If V is bigger than C,
right? So the question was, can you make this?
Yeah.
Okay. So and you say, well, if V is bigger than C,
you have
and you know that
right?
F has to be at least gamma 2 to 3, then that means that then this thing will also become imaginary.
Mm-hmm.
But then you have an imaginary force. Note, this whole thing together will be real, because you have two imaginary things that will together be real,
mm-hmm.
but a force is a measurable thing. The force itself should itself be real.
Yeah, but also just in the definition that we gave of force,
yes.
since we define force as, because what we said is, oh, we could find a force that is like V dependent, but what we did is like the big V function is by definition,
yes. Yes.
it's the opposite. It's not because we did it, it's force
yes.
is defined as the V function that
yes.
only depends on position.
Yes, I agree. And that was the third reason I was so blanking on during the break or before the break. And that is that, again, the only way to counteract the gamma 2 to 3 here is when F is V dependent. In what way? Well, this particular way. And there might be some other Vs floating around. But at the very least, that means that your capital V, here's where the notation becomes messy because we were playing around with this, but it means your potential energy cannot have been just x dependent. It should also have been v dependent. Otherwise, you will never get a v dependent force out.
So it's something else than the force. We get if we have something a function
yes.
that depends on the position and the speed. It's no more. We can no more call it a force because a force by definition
well,
is something
yes.
something that depends on the. Thing.
I very much agree.
So
it's
another like element.
Yes, but be careful. You're sort of making a semantic argument now that you say, well, dv, dx, we call that a force. Now you end up with some exoterm, so you cannot call it a force anymore.
Mm-hmm.
That's all fine. We cannot call the force anymore, but you can still write down the rule. And if you do that, if you make it a v-dependent thing, then that means that your Euler-Lagrange equation ends up with an exoterm. And the term will be something along the lines of this. Now, we can have a semantic discussion whether you call this a force or this whole thing the force.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care what you call what. But your acceleration will now depend on this extra term.
Right.
That was my third reason, that at the moment that you want your force to counteract the gamma to the 3-2, or the gamma to the 3 that you have here, it should be V-dependent, therefore your potential energy should be V-dependent, and that means that this derivation that we did not hold in the first place. You would have had an extra term there.
But is the problem that A depends on the extra
term? Well, that was something that we were discussing with a group of students during the break, and we don't have a definitive answer yet. In principle, I see no problem why this V, this capital V, doesn't contain a V. You have to counteract this because the Euler-Lagrange will give you an extra term. And then you can still write down what is the acceleration of that new thing. The acceleration coming from this whole new situation will be this.
And just how do we define A? Is it just like dv over dt or?
Yes, that's enough. It is.
Okay. So, but it's small v, so we imply that.
Well, just to stick to my line of reasoning for a second ago, before we go into another tangent, is that, yes, if you introduce a V-dependent potential energy, then your acceleration will look like this.
Mm-hmm.
You can ask yourself the same question one more time. When is the acceleration zero? In other words, what is the highest velocity? So that gives you here zero. Okay. And then I can think of reasons where, if you recall, this is the x derivative of my potential energy, this is a V derivative, and I can in principle think of potential energies of which the X derivative and the V derivative certainly can cancel out this one. I see no reason from physics why that could not happen.
Yeah.
So in principle, at the moment that I introduce V-dependent potential energies, mathematically I see reasons to conclude that there might be things going faster than speed of light, unless there is some higher rule preventing it, but I'm not sure right now what that higher rule would be. Now, here's a sort of a dodgy way of answering the question. All the forces that we have are either x-dependent potentials, they come from x-dependent potentials. If you have a V-dependent potential, and I'm sort of leaning on your understanding of classical mechanics, but you've ever heard of conservative force?
Yeah.
And it means that how you do the line integral
mm-hmm.
doesn't matter what
yeah.
path you've chosen.
Yeah.
And only if your force is conservative, then only then you can write the force as the derivative of a potential energy. Otherwise, simply the potential energy simply does not exist.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, you can play sort of the same thing here, because at the moment that your force is, you want your force to be V dependent, that means it cannot be a conservative force.
Oh, yeah.
Which is another way of saying is you cannot write it as a derivative of a scalar function. Now Giovanni came along and said, but you can still do it, but then your potential energy has to be a vector function. That is allowed. There's whole books written on this thing. In fact, this book that I showed during the tutorial, the Classical Mechanics by Goldstein, has actually a chapter on that. But you can already tell that if that you, because that force cannot be conservative anymore, because it depends on the path, right? If you go this way, you would have more friction, more V-dependent part than if you would have gone the other way, so therefore you cannot write it as a potential energy. So that means that if you want to write it as potential energy, you need a vector potential energy. And that means that you might end up with the situation that we had here, that the vector form of your potential energy sticks into the wrong direction to counteract your gamma. This is what I'm thinking if I'm thinking out loud. We'd have to check the books on this. I don't have a definitive answer here. Anyway, we're going to stick to x-dependent potential energies, and within that realm, everything is all fixed, yes? You cannot go faster than the speed of light. But it's a good question. It's something I would love to think about more. But we only have limited amount of time left, so let's forget about all this stuff. I promised you a second way that you cannot go faster than the speed of light. Oh! By the way, there's another statement in special relativity, and that is that yes, things can go with the speed of light, as long as the thing itself is massless. Can you also conclude that from what we have written down now? So I'm now back to the situation where potential energies can only depend on x, okay? So this rule holds. Can you see here why it, if something is massless, it is allowed to go with the speed of light? Just but from the mathematics alone?
Yeah, because then there's no acceleration.
There's no acceleration? I don't know.
If we can make also the kind of the game of the limits here, also like see what happens when
yes.
M tends to zero and what happens when V.
Yes. Suppose that you have something that does not have mass. Okay? So whatever mass is, it's not zero.
Well, can we just look at the exponent and see which one is the fastest?
Sure, but
then we will be able to like have cadastre and see which
correct.
One will be.
This is your limit idea once more, yes?
Yeah.
That you very carefully look at the limit, but we can be a little bit more quick and dirty. But you're correct, but we can be a little bit more quick and dirty about it. Let's rephrase the question. Suppose that you have an object that is massless. Let's start there. You have a massless object, so M is zero. And forget about this part, forget about this part for a while. What would the acceleration be?
Infinite.
Okay? So that means the thing would keep on accelerating, keep on accelerating, keep on accelerating. Now how can you counteract that? By the way, in order to accelerate something an indefinite amount of time,
ooh.
You need an indefinite amount of energy, yes?
Well, another way we can think of it is that if
yes.
it can keep accelerating, there is no limit to the acceleration.
Yes.
But there is no, we cannot say A is equal to zero, so we can say there is no limits, speed limit for the thing.
It's a rephrasing of the same point, but you're right, absolutely. At the moment that you make this zero, you look at something that is massless, you will find the acceleration is infinity. So it means it will just keep on going faster and going faster. If you look at the energy consideration of that thing, that means you need an infinite amount of energy in there. We don't have an infinite amount of energy, we have conserved energy. That's what we have found, right? Conserved energy means if you want something to go with, you want to squeeze an infinite amount of energy into somewhere, our conservation of energy that we have derived and have proven in this setting means that the energy must have come from somewhere.
But
yes,
we say that energy conserved, that not that is that it is finite.
No, but if you know that it's conserved, that means that whatever you're going to squeeze into this massless particle,
mm-hmm.
it has to have come from someplace else. That total sum has to be the same.
Yeah.
So that means that if you put an infinite amount here, you have extracted an infinite amount from someplace else. Okay, and if under the assumption that that is not possible, not because the ferrying of energy from this part into your particle is not possible, but simply because the thing that it gets energy from didn't have an infinite amount to begin with, okay, that holds under our assumption, or assumption, our mathematical result of energy is conserved. That means that the conclusion that massive particles have an infinite acceleration is simply not allowed by our conservation of energy. So if m is zero, something has to happen here to make sure that this thing is not infinite.
Can we say that something has no mass then?
Yes.
Because we can do it like the opposite way also. Is it possible for an object to have like zero mass?
Yes, photons, gravitational waves, gluons.
Yeah, so can you then make the stuff?
Just need to make the thing zero.
On top, infinite.
This thing.
Oh, we cannot apply any force on x. Does it mean that would it be like the interpretation? If we have like a massless object,
yes,
we can not interact with it or apply.
Well, it's hard to push against things
that don't have mass.
Yes.
I mean,
how about this?
Yeah. If you make that zero, it might.
If you make that zero, it counteracts the zero in the denominator. But it gives you an immediate that gives you an immediate consequence. Particles that do not have mass
must move
at the speed of light. Otherwise, they extract an infinite amount of energy from the rest of the world, and they don't. So it's not just that particles that have no mass can be accelerated to the speed of light.
They must.
They have to go with the speed of light. There's no other choice. Nature does not leave open any other option.
Mm-hmm.
I want to stress one more time that all of this came only from our assumption that we have Lagrangian physics and that it has to be invariant. So look how much we get, yes? And how little we put in. So, big conclusion here. Massive particles cannot go with the speed of light. Massless particles have to go with the speed of light. No exceptions. Okay. This is based on our... all of this came from this. You have a little bit amount of time left. Let's go with the energy thing. Now, you can already guess what you're going to do during the tutorial. Find the expression for the energy. Okay? How are we on time? 15 minutes? Should I give you the expression and then conclude, or should I just let you derive the expression? Well, you have to do that anyway, but also do the conclusion yourself. What do you feel like?
Maybe us.
I'll have to give you the expression, yeah?
Yep.
Okay. This is what you will get. It's what we had before, plus extra. So this energy expression comes from this. Is it conserved, by the way? We have an energy. The question is it conserved?
Yes.
Yeah.
There is no time dependence.
Yeah.
I hear some yeses. That's good. That's correct. How do you know?
No time dependence.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Our Lagrangian still does not have any explicit time dependence. We've proven it for a general case. If you want, you can also explicitly, you know, take the ddt of this thing and just go through the derivation and actually show explicitly that it is zero also in this case. Now, let's go back to our original question. How about letting things go with the speed of light?
What?
Question is, you have a massive particle and you want to let it go with the speed of light.
Mm-hmm.
This is the energy that that particle will have, yes?
Mm-hmm.
If you see it go with the speed of light. Is that possible? Let me help you out just a little bit.
We don't have the speed. Oh,
okay.
Sigma.
You
just wrote out together.
You need an infinite amount of
energy.
One more time?
You need an infinite amount of energy.
How can you tell?
Because of the gamma.
Forget about this part. You're right. This part alone will go to infinity if that particle goes with the speed of light.
Yeah.
So that means you need an infinite amount of energy to let that particle go with the speed of light. Now, you can put a lot of energy in there, and there the same consideration as before comes along, that you can get energy from the rest of the world as long as the total sum is conserved. We've proved that. But if you want to have an infinite amount of energy into that one particle to make it go with the speed of light, then you must have got an infinite amount of energy from the rest of the world. So, here's from an energy point of view why things, masses, cannot go with the speed of light. Now, during the course, all 6 weeks, we constantly were very close to that conclusion, but it was only sort of, you know, based on, well, something becomes imaginary, something strange happens there. But here's an actual proof both on energy considerations and forces. I have one more comment to make, but please go ahead.
Yeah. So if you take infinite amount of energy from everything else, would that mean that something with a mass can start going at the speed of light, but everything else will stop moving at all?
Depends.
No, because no, that's okay. I love that. Oh, well. No, honestly, during those last, you know, month and a half, a little bit more, what I extremely enjoyed from this group, even more than from the usual groups that I have, is how many good ideas come. Okay, so let me paraphrase you. Let's see if I get the question correctly. You're saying that suppose that it does get an infinite amount of energy from the rest of the universe, right? That's allowed by the conservation of energy. Does it mean that the rest of the universe then must stand still? Okay?
Or move in the opposite direction with an infinite velocity.
No, because the going in the other direction still costs energy.
Yeah.
It's because of the V squared. It doesn't care about the direction
yeah.
they're moving.
Yeah.
Would it like cool down to 0 Kelvin?
Oh,
I have two counter points here.
Yeah, but remember that mass is energy, right?
Yeah.
So
well, mass is energy?
Yeah, mass is energy.
Is mass energy?
Yeah, it is equal to mc squared.
Only if you only in the reference frame where the thing does not move with respect to you. Not all mass is energy. Some mass is kinetic energy. Or some energy is
actually,
kinetic energy.
If
yeah,
everything else stops, then you only have two reference frames.
Listen, if I'm moving, okay? Well, that will be my second point. There's two points I want to make here as a counterexample. So I think the answer to the question is no. First of all, if I'm walking here and you want to you really want to go at the speed of light and you extract my energy, yes, the more energy you extract from me, the slower I will go, right? You steal my kinetic energy. At some point, I will stand still. You cannot extract any more energy from me. So the maximum amount of energy you can extract from my kinetic energy is just the difference in how fast I was walking before and how fast I'm walking now, which is zero. But it's a finite amount.
But is it only kinetic energy or is it potential energy?
You're also free to take my potential energy in the form
still
of mc squared.
Amount.
But that's also a finite amount. You need an infinite amount. You can only get so much.
But now you're
assuming that the universe consists of an infinite amount of particles from which you can get the energy.
And it's also the rate.
We do not know anything about that.
But
also
the...
Also, would it necessarily stand still? Because what if it was moving at a constant rate?
That was my second point, and I think somebody mentioned it here as well, that me standing still is not an invariant statement.
Yeah.
So the amount of energy you can extract from me...
But also,
I think there's some subtleties there.
I'm thinking also something. It's also the rate at which you absorb energy.
Yes.
So normally you should absorb all the energy in the same, in an infinite amount of time. But we see that we are limited in our action, like by the cone of light. So there is elements on which we cannot attract energy from. So we are limited in the amount of total energy we can like attract in one specific time. And if you want to go...
That's a good point too, because even if you would have an infinite amount of particles from which you could extract all their kinetic and or potential energies, right? But you would still need an infinite amount of particles because you need an infinite amount of energy. You can get a finite amount from one particle, one mass. Then the question is, well, how much of these are outside of your light cone in a finite amount of time?
So you can only extract energy from the observable universe, which is finite.
But it grows in time, right? The longer you wait, the bigger your universe. But that means that you need to wait an infinite amount of time before everything in the universe is in your light cone.
and when stuff moves away as well, due to expansion of the universe.
That is a second
but
point, but that I think is practically the same thing as saying you cannot get an infinite amount of energy from the rest of the universe, because even if you could, even if you would have some mechanism to get the energy from other particles, you would have to at least wait until all of the universe in your light cone, which takes an infinite amount of time. Now, to me, waiting an infinite amount, which is a second. To me, waiting an infinite amount of time before you have all the energy to you yourself go with the speed of light, is saying that it will not happen, because you have to wait an infinite amount. If you have to wait for something an infinite amount of time before it happens, that's the same thing as saying it will never happen.
Oh, we can see the opposites. In a very short amount of time, like almost infinite, like time zero, I must absorb like everything which is possible. So if I take a very short thing, like I can see that the only disposable energy that I can have like is very short. And what I need is like at time t0, I need the infinite amount of energy. Although at time t0, the amount of energy I can have or bigger is finite.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, that's pretty much the same point. That if you only give yourself a small amount, a finite amount of time, could be small, could be big, but not infinite.
We'll have a finite amount of energy.
Yes.
Whereas we need an infinite thing.
Exactly, because you only have a finite amount of things within your light cone at that moment. Anyway, one last point that I wanted to make, and that's, by the way, this is all of the classical mechanics, yes? So what we have found now is that if somebody gives you the potential energy that a particle feels, in classical mechanics you would just subtract this amount of potential energy from 1/2 mv squared, you do your stuff, you get your laws of physics out, and including what the thing will do. In relative physics is exactly the same thing, but instead of taking for the Lagrangian kinetic energy, you don't take 1/2 mv squared, you take this thing, but otherwise you do exactly the same. You end up with the relativistic version of Newton's second law, and as a mathematical bonus you will get that things will not go faster than the speed of light, and if something is massless it has to go with the speed of light. Now, a couple of more comments. Doing this in practice might be mathematically very difficult, because if somebody gives you a force, gravity, spring force, whatever it is, what you usually do in Newtonian physics is that, right, you would have this. You would put the force in, and you end up with a differential equation, typically, right? This thing might be x-dependent. You get a differential equation. The position of the thing is in this way related to the second derivative of the position. You have to solve what the position function is, and you get how the thing will move through space. But at the moment that you have the gamma here, it becomes much more difficult, because all of a sudden the position that you're looking for appears here as its acceleration, and in a very non-trivial way, in the velocity in that thing. From a mathematical point of view, you get a much more difficult differential equation. We all know what we're talking about, yes? Differential equation means you have an equation, one side of the equation tells you the thing that you're looking for, the other side of the equation tells you the derivative of the thing that you're looking for, or the second, or the third, or the fifth derivative. In original Newton's laws, you have the thing that you're looking for on one side, x, and on the other side you have two derivatives of that same x, and then look for the x. It's a function in that case. But now, in relativistic physics, you have the thing that you're looking for, x, somewhere built in here. On this side you have the second derivative of the thing that you're looking for, and 1 over the square root to the third, or 1 minus the thing you're looking for, derivative over c squared. That is mathematically much more difficult. For the people who are doing differential equations, this is a linear differential equation. This is a nonlinear differential equation. Here's the crappy part. Mathematics tells you, but a nonlinear differential equation means that the thing that you're looking for appears to some power in your equation. Here it does, because it appears in the v squared somewhere in a non-trivial way. Now, crappy thing from mathematics, there is no general rule to solve non-linear differential equations.
Yet, or they will never be?
No, you can prove that the rule does not exist. Okay. The solutions exist, but there's no rule that always will give you the solution. That means that every time that you do this exercise in relativity, you have to find your new ad hoc rule for the case that be. Not so in Newtonian physics, because you have tricks to solve this for every single F that you want to put in. That makes relativistic mechanics much more difficult. The force might be just as easy as in the Newtonian case, It's this part, the A and the V squared part that's built into here, that makes it extremely difficult. So difficult that mathematicians have proven that there's no general rule to solve it. Again, makes it much more difficult. So, I'm sorry, this is what nature does, apparently. But in principle, if somebody gives you a force, and you put it into here, and you calculate what A is as a function of time, or you can, in principle, find what the solution is, but you just have to find your own rule how to do it. You will find your solution, and you know how things will move. In the tutorial, I'm going to ask you to solve this equation for one particular case, one for which, if you're a little bit clever, you find your little ad hoc rule on the spot. If not, I will help you, of course. And this is how you do red physics mechanics. Long story short, throughout this course, we first took a couple of weeks to look at how things look from different inertial systems. We now have the rules how you can calculate how things will move if you start pushing them around in inertial systems. And that, in principle, is all of special relativity. The rest is just practice. Giovanni, you had a question, I think?
Yeah.
Yes.
When we talked about the last line, so E equals to, we said that energy is going to be infinite for particles moving at speed of light.
Yes.
The term gamma down is
infinite.
We know that a particle moving at the speed of light is the same thing as saying it's equivalent to say that the particle doesn't have mass.
Yes.
So also the upper term is zero.
Yes.
So we cannot say that it's, we cannot deduce out of this fact that the energy is infinite.
No.
I said if it has a mass.
If it has a mass, then you need an infinite amount of energy. If it, and your point is that if it goes with the speed of light, and you make the mass zero, then you don't know if it's infinite.
Ah, okay.
So you're proving the point that we made before, that massless particles have to have no mass. Oh, excuse me. Massless particles have to go with the speed of light.
Yeah.
So that's the same point over again. By the way, that doesn't mean that particles that go with the speed of light don't have energy. They have energy. It's just not given by this expression.
But we cannot stop them then.
That's also true.
You cannot stop or block or change a direction.
Relativity tells you that you can't. But the point that I want to make here is that doesn't mean that the particles do not have energy. It's just not given by this expression. This expression gives you something that you don't know, because then you would have 0/0, which has a value, but it's not given by this expression. Do you know how you get energies for photons?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's not from relativity, because this equation is silent on that.
Frequency?
Yeah.
Constant, Planck's constant, times the frequency.
Yeah.
So if you've ever wondered why you have all these rules for energies of particles, and all of a sudden for photons here's this completely different rule, here's the reason. The thing doesn't allow to be used for massless particles.
But then I'm just thinking, if it must always go to the speed of light,
yes.
If we have a particle massless, we cannot can we deviate it? We cannot deviate it, no?
Yes, you can, with the curved space-time. Yes, but otherwise you can't.
Normally in that particular thing we couldn't be able to change the course of it or just
we have lenses.
Slow it down or
we cannot slow it down, but we can get it into a different direction. That's what a lens does.
Yeah.
Yes. But it's not by pushing.
But doesn't it count as a force being able to change the course of the direction of a
not really, I mean
I thought if we have the speed and we just change its direction, then you can also see as a change of speed or
sure.
An acceleration. No,
I agree. An acceleration in direction, not in magnitude.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
So that is still because if you have a circle, for example, like orbiting, it still changed not in magnitude, but at least
yes. But if you want, you can call it a force because you have changed the momentum. So in principle, you could assign the word force to it, but it's not what people typically do.
Okay.
The
point is normally I couldn't apply any force on a particle.
Yes. But you cannot apply force to it in the mechanical Newtonian kind of sense of the word. But you can change its direction.
Yeah, but that's why I don't get it. You can change it. For me, a change of direction, you can change of speed.
No, but this is just semantics. The effect is that you can change the direction of a photon. You cannot change the magnitude, but you can change its direction. And the semantic part is whether you want to call that a force or not. Now, mechanically speaking, you don't call it a force, but the effect is, of course, is still there. You just call it different.
People, see you in one moment, yeah? MBB.
Quick question.
Yes.